Welcome to Command Control Power, a weekly podcast hosted by three certified members of the Apple Consultants Network, drawing from nearly half a century of combined experience. We talk shop, interview vendors and colleagues, and share what we've learned while operating our technology consulting practices. This is Joe Saponari of CIMAC, and my two co-hosts are Jerry Zygmunt of MacWorks and Sam Valencia of the HCS Technology Group. We also offer a weekly email newsletter, which includes show notes for each episode. Learn more at commandcontrolpower.com. And thanks for listening. This episode of Command Control Power is brought to you commercial-free and is made possible by our Patreon sponsors. You can help bring more commercial-free episodes by going to patreon.com/cmdctrlpwr and supporting the show with a monthly pledge. Thank you for your support of Command Control Power.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of Command Control Power. We are very pleased to be joined by Armin Breigel of Scripting OS 10, coming all the way from Holland. Welcome, Armin.
Well, thanks so much for having me. It is great, even though it's a bit late here.
Thank you for joining us at this late hour. What is it, around midnight over there right now?
Yeah, we just passed midnight. So it's actually tomorrow here. I come from the future.
That's funny. We have a couple listeners from Australia, so we like to often make those jokes over there as well. I'm sure they're tired of those. But yeah, I appreciate you being here. You know, it's been quite a while since we last spoke. And of course, you're hard at work as usual. And we want to talk about your book during the show as well. And how have things been for you?
We are all in this weird pandemic situation. I think overall, the picture in Europe was similar to how it happened in the States, though I think the details played out differently and probably over different timelines as well.
One of the things that we talk about here on this show is it's all about our personal experiences. Everyone's been affected differently. We're coming from a real straightforward perspective of this is what's happened to me. You know, we can't speak for everyone in our country, just like you can't for yours. It sounds like you're doing all right. You're still hard at work and writing like crazy, it seems.
Yeah, we are doing well. I mean, I have been working out of the home office from way before the pandemic and try to do as much of my work as I can remotely or online. But then suddenly, of course, my wife, who's a professor at the university here, had to stay home. We had to set up a desk and everything. And my son, who is 17, was homeschooling. I am personally very glad that I didn't have younger children because I could imagine just how disruptive that would be. We had my niece, who is studying in The Hague, also moved in here because of the lockdown and everything. We all decided it would be better to have her with family. Her parents are in the UK right now. And suddenly we had four adults here. I had to up the Wi-Fi and strengthen the network and make sure everything worked. But strange experiences, nothing you could have imagined even. We've had lockdowns here as well. The summer was kind of quiet and mostly unrestricted, but then over the winter we are back in lockdown, and they have now extended it until into April here.
Well, that is really interesting because, as we mentioned just prior to starting the show tonight, things seem to be easing up just a little bit here in the United States. I think they've done a pretty good job of rolling out the vaccines. It's highly dependent on the area and the part of the United States that you actually live in. Has the government given you any sort of, or the local municipality for you, given any timeline in terms of when you might be able to expect to get your first round of vaccines for you and your family?
At least in the Netherlands, they are adamant that they will, at least the first shot, be available to everyone by the summer, but they haven't done anything more specific than that. My parents, who are in Germany, they should be able to schedule their shots soon. But of course, they're a generation older than me, so you would expect them to get it much earlier.
Yeah.
So the vaccine rollout has been a bit slower here in Europe than it is going on in the States right now.
So all you folks from the USA that are listening that are planning that summer trip to Europe, you may want to put the brakes on that and rethink it and do and at least for a little while longer.
That's, or Armin could put them up.
That's right. We could stay in your house.
We actually had, as I said, my wife is a professor at the university, and she had a new postdoc starting. She came from Hawaii in the fall, and we had to put them up in our guest room for 10 days in quarantine before she could start actually working her job. That was an interesting experience. It worked well. Very nice people.
Well, that's comforting for me because it sounds like you got a lot of room, and I hear you got really good Wi-Fi now. So Sam and right. I can purchase the tickets. What do you think, Sam?
I'm game for it. I mean, especially 10 days in the room, I guess you'll just bring me food during those times, right?
Definitely will, yes. You know, we all work remotely, so that'll work out.
That's the other challenge. Upping the Wi-Fi, upping the network bandwidth is huge because same thing happened in my house. You're not ready for the onslaught or the network isn't. And the other thing that I wasn't prepared for is my heating bill over this winter. My goodness, went through the roof because of, you know, all of us being home all day for a lot of portion of it. And we were just heating the house the entire time. So I started going back to chopping firewood again and heating up via fireplace. Over the time that we've seen this shift everything to virtual, what are you seeing in terms of things that used to be in person? Like many of us have attended conferences over the years, some great ones in this country as well as around the world. What are you seeing out there in terms of planning even towards end of this year to being live and in person? Or are they still scouting out for virtual conferences and planning that for the rest of 2021?
I myself just put in a speaker proposal for the Jamf Nation User Conference in October. They went ahead and declared, you know what, this insecurity and uncertainty, that's not good for us. We will just go ahead and do it virtual again this year, even though it's in October. Most other conferences that are scheduled for the fall timeframe are still holding on, haven't announced anything yet. But I have also seen other conferences that are more like in the summer, Mac DevOps YVR and the PSU Mac Admins Conf. They have said they will be virtual, actually scheduled to be virtual. Mac DevOps YVR already has the ticketing available online. I fear, even with the vaccines going out, but the different situations in the different countries, and the lead time you need to plan a conference and the speakers need to plan their talks, because you prepare a talk very differently, whether it's virtual or on stage. I think that this fall is probably very optimistic. We might have local meetings by then, but nothing, no big international conferences.
Now, the Jamf conference, I know Sam attends that regularly. This will actually be good news for you, Sam. You won't have to take your orange Jamf jumpsuit out from the cleaners quite yet. You could leave it there a couple more months. But Armin, was that virtual last year, and did you do a virtual presentation? Maybe you could just touch briefly on how that is for you. I mean, that is always a challenge for anyone, even when we're doing just a Zoom conference. What's it like to present? Is it actually easier or is it much harder remotely?
It is entirely different. At the beginning, I had a real challenge with I'm sitting in my living room or in my office and I am talking with the screen and you don't get feedback. Mm-hmm. It's really hard. Everybody's polite, turns off their microphones and maybe their camera, and you really don't get any feedback. And that is hugely irritating in the beginning. But you get kind of used to it. And then you realize that the preparation phase for these conferences is very different. Several conferences, including JNUC and the Mac SysAdmin, they had pre-recorded sessions.
I see. So, but when you're presenting live, it must feel like you're talking to yourself after a while. You know, after about 20 minutes, it's like you say, you're not getting any feedback at all and everybody's quiet. It almost seems like you're alone in the forest broadcasting.
Yeah, you do get used to it. I mean, when I prepare presentations and conferences, I am home alone practicing them anyway.
Right.
And I just had to get in the mindset, like, this is just like a practice run. The cat is my audience. I can work with this. When I realized the pre-recorded sessions, I basically produced them much differently. So instead of memorizing and having the entire presentation in my head, which I need to do when I'm on stage, I just build 3 to 5 minute segments, record them 4 or 5 times until I get a take that I like. And then, you know, iMovie, I can put them all together. It's a very different way of preparing. It's not necessarily less work, might even be more work. It's different.
You mentioned some people obviously turning their microphones off, but also their cameras off. And I find that to be terribly difficult because I'm talking about live here. If I'm going to throw a joke out there, I want to see if it lands. I want to see someone chuckle even if they're muted. And I go, okay, that landed. I'm going to use that one again. If I have no visual on them, it's near impossible for me to gauge, am I even doing well? I was listening to my daughter. She was in class the other day. All the students, high school students, have their cameras off. And one of the teachers kind of tried to crack a joke. And she was just like, you know, anyone like unmute themselves and laugh because I'm struggling over here. And she was just like clearly in an uncomfortable place. So when you're talking about presenting to people that have their cameras off, I think that really defeats me in terms of feeling a connection with anybody.
Yeah, and it depends on the group size. I mean, if I'm presenting to 5, 8, or 10 people, and then most people will have their cameras on, and it's a much closer to real situation, closer to in person. But at my JNUC presentation, they had this very elaborate presentation system. I think there were 700 people watching my session live.
Wow.
Which was an amazing experience, even though it was a pre-recorded session. So I was just in the chat room answering questions and replying to feedback. Years back when I worked at Apple, I did a developers conference session, and there were maybe 500 people in the room, which is hugely intimidating and stressful. And it's much nicer to sit there, have a pre-recorded session running that you know will just be fine because you recorded it, and then watch, and you're like, oh, this is a new record. I have 700 people watching that. It's much less stressful. I kind of enjoyed that. But yeah, you miss the feedback. You miss the thrill of being on stage. I can't wait to get back to real conferences and meeting people.
Even going to the smaller ones, like whether it be a user group in a closed town by you or something like that, just feeling that connection with people is sorely missed. I'm definitely looking forward to it as well. You applied to speak at JNUC this year. Any other places that you're planning on presenting to yet?
Well, most of them haven't announced yet, but I will definitely want to do something for Mac Sysadmin again, which is usually in Gothenburg. And we will have to see what their plans are going to be. No pressure, Patrick, if you're listening. And then I'll see. I did 3 presentations last year, and they ended up being in July and then 2 of them in October. So all of them within like 4 months. And that was actually quite exhausting. As everyone now records their sessions and puts them online, you can't just reuse the same presentation for everything. I have to build a new presentation for everything. And 3 major presentations was a bit exhausting. So I might just stick with the 2 until somebody asks me nicely and I'm a pushover. So we will see.
I didn't even think about that. That's a terrific point, is that you can't, if you're presenting it electronically and they're presenting it as a pre-recorded session, you can't send them the same file, you know, and just register for all these conferences. So yeah, that's a great point. Wow, I didn't even think about that.
Totally. I mean, it just blows my mind that you even said that. Imagine going to 2 conferences and be like, oh yeah, Armin's going to speak again. Oh man, it's the same damn thing. Yeah, that's got to be difficult, and having to produce that all at the same time is, man, not easy. I do hope to see something when it is safe to do so in 2022. I can't believe I'm already talking about 2022, but at that point in time, when we can start to hopefully safely mingle with people and potentially travel and get into that mindset again of interacting with people. You know, I'm glad to hear that you'll be potentially speaking at JNUC. I'm looking forward to hearing the presentation as well. Hopefully it'll be even more than 700 this time. One of the reasons why you're here, I'd love to get to, which is talking about your latest book, because apparently you're never busy enough, so you're always writing. So you've written a great book called macOS Terminal and Shell. Take us down the road of where it's available and what the book's about.
So the book is macOS Terminal and Shell. It's available on Apple Books in all 51 countries or regions that allow me to self-publish to. I pushed it out in February, so it's been there for 4 weeks. I'm getting great feedback, and I'm really excited. I started self-publishing in 2016. We had moved from the States back to Europe, and I was kind of taking a bit of a break in between work because of the move, and my son was going to a new school and everything. I still wanted to do something, so I thought, you know, I've always wanted to write a book. I'm vain like that. I think I have something to say. And I started writing the book, and the very first thing I actually wanted to write was this big Mac admin everything book, and I just realized that would be like 1500 pages in size and would take me years and years. And by the time I'd finished it, I could start over because Apple is moving so fast and everything's changing. And so I went down to simpler topics, and I have managed to publish a book every year so far, except for 2020, where because of all the things that we discussed earlier, couldn't quite finish that book. I then finished it over the Christmas break and was able to publish it in February this year.
So let me ask you a tough question. There's been a couple stabs at people writing about Terminal and Shell in the past. You know, even our own Sam Valencia actually did a video series on Terminal. I don't know if you know that, Armin.
I did not. Yeah. I have to look at that.
That's years ago at this point.
So why this subject? I'm playing devil's advocate here, but the other side of the coin is, you know, people listen to this and they go like, oh yeah, I know Terminal. Like, what can Armin tell me? So tell us how you got to this subject.
So all of my other books that I've written so far have this sentence very early in the start that says, when you read this book, you should feel comfortable using Terminal on macOS. Because I talk about packaging, I talk about macOS installation, and the way I work in Terminal a lot. I think it's very powerful and useful. And yeah, you need Terminal. And I always assumed that you should know Terminal when you read my books. But it always felt like a cheap way out, because the people who maybe say, well, I'm probably not so comfortable with Terminal, or I never even opened Terminal, they might feel that they don't have something, that they can't read my books. And I didn't want that. So finally, I got around to writing this book. And I say finally, but after I published the book, I kind of cleaned up the project folder. And I noticed that I had started writing this book in 2015.
Oh, wow.
There was an outline file from 2015. And I was surprised how close the final table of contents was actually to that outline. I started and stopped it. There were other books I had wanted to write in between that were more timely and just more in the moment. And then I finally got to finish it over last year and then this spring.
With regards to Terminal, it's one of those things, and I've said it before on this show as well, a lot of Mac people that support the Mac operating system don't necessarily know it. They know how to maybe copy and paste a command, let's say, that they read on a site of how to fix something. But I think it's very important to get to the heart of what this Unix-based operating system is all about and be able to perform tasks under the hood. And at the very least, learn that command that you just copied and pasted. Learn the argument there and understand exactly what it did so that for next time, you may not have to copy and paste. You may be able to do this on your own and figure it out and apply it elsewhere for a problem that you're solving. And not even talking about scripting, you know, just running some basic commands within the shell. So I got to be honest, I was pretty excited about this book because it's hard to find a good book on the subject matter. There's a lot of websites and poorly performed videos like my own that's taken stabs at this, but I really do enjoy the fact that this is available. Whether or not they know they need it or not, there are a lot of Mac admins out there that should be diving deeper into the Terminal and having a better understanding of it.
Yeah, and that was kind of the motivation. I mean, there are other books, and there are some good books about Terminal, but they are, I won't say superficial, but they don't go very deep. They're just like, here's Terminal, and this is how you do defaults commands, and they give you a good overview, but they don't go very deep. And I wanted to have this for the technical-minded person that you might not have deep experience with Terminal yet. I start with the basics. I start with the things you really need to know. And then I go deep on certain things and think, well, yeah, I get a different perspective into macOS. When you're working in the Terminal, you see things differently. You can do different things. And you have to know some different things. And I try to explain those in detail. And then I also wanted to be very macOS specific because there are some excellent books about Bash or Z Shell out there, but they are usually written for the other Unix systems and Linux systems. And we all know that Mac is different and special. Even though it is Unix in the core, it has its own things on top of that that make it different. So I wanted to cover all of these things, and I hope I struck the balance in a good way.
So for the average person listening to the show that may not necessarily be a real Terminal ninja and maybe just barely scratching the surface, maybe one of you gentlemen can give us an example of where you can really unharness the power of Terminal that would maybe help you at a client site or working with your own computer.
I have a good example for that. One of the sections in the book that I actually spend a lot of time on is file metadata. And of course, you have to talk about all the weird arcane Unix privileges and the RWX and the octal numbers. But macOS very specifically adds lots of other metadata to files all the time in extended attributes. Mm-hmm. And you probably have encountered those when you download files and they get quarantined and suddenly you can't launch it, or it refuses to launch it, or you get that weird, I won't launch this because it might be malicious and not signed and all of these. In the book, we explain what actually happens, how you can see all of these metadata pieces and how you can remove them if you need to and inspect them. So you get this more granular approach to things that you encounter every day, because we see this dialogue and you see the information like, oh yeah, you downloaded this in Safari on that and that date. How does the Finder know that? And we can explore these things in Terminal. And if we need to manipulate them on a very different level than the graphical user interface allows us to do. I think that is very useful for people, even if they're not in Terminal every day, but we can get more access and more information.
Yeah, I think it's important that everybody delve into this a little bit. And sometimes people look at using a tool like Terminal and think like, well, it's spinach. I know it's good for me, but I don't really like the taste of it and I have to eat it from time to time. There's so many reasons why it can be a really amazing tool for you in your consultancy practice.
I think you're right to some degree too, Jerry. It's like, many people might not know the why. Like, why do I need to know this? And that's where they need to be provided with some clarity there so that they can understand it. And reading a book like this can help not only perform the tasks, but understand the why. And that's incredibly important. You know, I know I always push the MDM bandwagon all the time, and I'm always talking about that to some degree. But there's also a combination of that, of like, through being able to manage 5 computers at Nana's home, you can send a command through Terminal or a scriptable command via MDM to do something cool. And it doesn't have to be that you're supporting 500 computers. You could be supporting 5, and it just makes your job easier because you only had to do something once. You know, and those are the little things that I think people don't always appreciate, that it doesn't always have to be for the large scale environment. I credit Armin on this book because I think you'll get a lot of positive feedback from people wanting to learn more about that.
I really hope that it hits the spot. The other thing where the Terminal is very relevant is, of course, it is the first step into scripting and automation. You don't have to be a scripter to profit from using the Terminal. If your goal is eventually to write scripts and automate stuff, you really have to be comfortable in the Terminal to start out with. So in this book, I tried to draw the line, and it wasn't always very clear, but I tried to draw a line and say, this is just using Terminal interactively, and this would be scripting, and I'm saving that for the next book.
And of course, your book covers ZSH, which is now the default shell. I'm reading your notes, but you also cover Bash, and you are completely compliant with any of the subtle nuances that Big Sur brings to the table. That's the great thing about electronic publishing, is you don't have this shelf life that you get with other printed books that we had years ago. By the time it hit the Barnes & Noble, you know, it was already, you know, 3 to 6 months old. So this is great.
Yes. And, you know, I started the book about 3 years ago in earnest. And back then, Bash was still the default shell. So I had to go back in last summer and walk through everything and see, like, okay, this is the same in Z Shell. This is different. I left all of the Bash specific pieces in there or put them in an appendix so that if you, for some reason, decide to continue to use Bash, the information is there. But the book is written with Z Shell in mind primarily. And in all honesty, in most day-to-day life, they behave nearly exactly the same. There are a few pieces where Z Shell is very different from Bash, and I mentioned those. But in most cases, they behave the same. But the Bash information is still in the book. So if you encounter like old documentation that will probably be written against Bash, you can probably compare it and at least understand it if it generates conflicts.
This is something that you're happy about too, because this is kind of an appetizer to all the other things that you discuss, not only on your site, but in your other books and your other presentations. So you could whet your appetite reading this book and then be like, oh, Armin does all this other stuff. I can read Moving to ZSH. I can look at the Terminal Witchcraft presentation. You know, you can, there's a lot that open people's eyes that don't have this experience that now see all the other pieces that you do. So that's kind of cool too for your benefit. I mean, there's that nice appetizer that you're providing to people now.
Using Terminal is just a very good foundation for just using your Mac more efficiently, especially for us in technical jobs. When I published the Moving to Z-Shell book, it's now nearly 2 years ago, when Catalina came out and Apple announced we are now using Z-Shell as the default shell, I basically just documented my own path away from Bash and learning how to use Z-Shell as efficiently as I did know Bash very well, and I wanted to use Z-Shell in the same way and configure it to my needs. And that was Moving to Z-Shell. So that book is written for somebody, you are already comfortable with Terminal on macOS with Bash, and how do I move to Z-Shell? And the new book is a different target audience. It's like, yeah, you are a bit comfortable with Terminal or not at all, and you want to learn it and go into depth. There is a bit of overlap between the two books, especially when I get into how to configure the Z-Shell, if you want one of those flashy prompts instead of the standard boring one. There's a lot of overlap in that area. Mostly these two books actually have different target audiences.
I'm a little curious about the self-publishing aspect of working within Apple's context here. So what is the process involved there? Obviously, you create your book, and then what steps do you need to take? Because you are publishing it yourself, so you're editing it, you're proofreading it. Does someone have to vet the book on Apple's end? How long does that kind of a process take?
So first of all, I have to thank, because over the years, I've built a loyal and extremely good team of proofreaders who do this entirely voluntarily. Their feedback is just so valuable. They correct my atrocious spelling. English is not my first language. They make it look like it, though. It is really grateful. And they also find pieces like duplicated text or just explain something twice within a few pages. And when you write that, you don't necessarily notice that. But somebody right. reads through it and says, you know, this is redundant. This needs to be reordered. So these people are a huge help. But then Apple makes that amazingly simple. So you need an Apple ID and you need to set up an account towards the Apple Book Store, which isn't that hard. And then you go into Pages, and there's actually a menu option which says Publish to Apple Books. You walk through those steps, and suddenly you have a book online. Apple does validate the book the first time you upload it. It takes about 24 hours, maybe a bit more. But I think they just go through the structure of the book. So it's an EPUB, EPUB version 3, which is basically extended HTML. And I think they go through and see if the structure and everything, the tags are okay, if there's no malicious JavaScript in there, which you technically could insert. If you're building the book in Pages, I've never had an issue. It just takes that validation check, which I think is fully automatic. I don't believe a human touches that. And then your book is in the store. It's pretty easy and straightforward.
That sounds pretty magical.
The nice thing is it's software. So I can publish updates to the books. As you said, I mean, when Apple does their big releases, obviously I try to get an update out very close to that. But also, when you write that book, you get to the point where, I just want to finish this, I'm tired of this. And then a month or two later, you think, I think I want to add a chapter on this or a section on this. And I can just put that in and push out an update. And everybody who already purchased the book just gets that update for free, put in there. And that is really cool. I really like that. It takes a lot of pressure off the feeling that it has to be perfect on the first try.
That's so great. And, you know, you've priced the book very reasonably. Your book is $19.99. if I had to buy that printed version of that, I'd be paying more money for it. And like you say, it's instantly updated. And when you decide you want to add something down the road, you know, there are these addendums which just magically appear on your iPad or however you're reading this book. So good value all the way around. You know, what I'm curious about, your book ends up being a profitable endeavor, or is it more of a labor of love? I think you just answered the question.
It doesn't pay off for the time you put in. I don't think any book, whether you go through a publisher or whether you self-publish, pays off for the actual time you put in. There are effects of the book. Since I've been publishing these books, I go to more conferences. I meet different people. I talk with different people, which I find extremely rewarding. So I will keep doing this. It's a nice addition to my income, let's put it that way.
Right, to your portfolio too, yeah. Plus, you know, you get all the terminal groupies that show up when you appear. You know, that's a benefit too.
They can be very, very picky on certain small things that I usually don't think about. Think about VI versus Emacs and all of these other things. There are people that feel very passionately about very many details in Terminal in the Shell.
It's very true. I mean, you know, even down to like calling something a hashtag versus a sharp versus an octothorpe. I mean, people get pretty bent out of shape about calling it the wrong thing sometimes. So that kind of falls right in line with that. But yeah, that's always been my concern about putting my personal work out there, is a critic that could come towards me for that. But like you've said, what you've gained out of this is not just monetary in value, but the ability to speak to many people on a lot of different levels, whether it's meeting someone individually or speaking at a conference and gaining that understanding that you might learn something from someone else out there too. I think that's a big benefit of this whole community aspect of things. I, for one, am, you know, happy to see another published work out of you. And it sounds like, I don't want to read the tea leaves too much, but that you're already hard at work at something else based on what I've heard during the conversation.
I'm not making a secret out of this. The next book will be on scripting. And I want to do the same approach. Like, we started nothing. We assume you know nothing about shell scripting and build up from there, but also try to build up not just to some superficial knowledge, but some really useful, deep knowledge specifically for macOS. That's my goal. I've started on it. I'm really enjoying this one because in my web blog, it's called Scripting OS 10. Automation and workflows, that's what I do. That's what I really enjoy. And this book, it's amazing that it took me 5 years and five other books to get to this one. But now it has to be.
Nice. We're looking forward to seeing that come out at some point in the near future. You do own the domain Scripting macOS, right?
Yes.
Do you foresee any kind of transition into scriptingmacOS.com?
I have thought about, you know, how long will Mac and macOS be with us? Am I just moving into a different dead end here? And I don't want to paint a bleak future here. I think it will be with us for a few more years. I have thoughts about that. And depending on how my time works out this year, there might be some changes I'll do to the website and weblog, but no official comments yet.
Fair enough. And I will say to people, go to scriptingos10.com and subscribe to the newsletter. You put out some great information that's really helpful to the community, not just, you know, your information, but also things about, like we talked about with conferences, podcasts that you might want to listen to, other resources that are available. So I highly recommend going out and signing up for that newsletter.
And the other great thing is that if you're listening to this podcast and you're saying, it does sound interesting and I'm not sure I want to spend the money, you can get a sample from Apple Books. What could be better than that? Take a look at the sample information. Hopefully you'll want to purchase the book outright.
And you can't just get the sample from Apple Books. I actually have the series basically turned into the first chapter of this book. It's still available on my weblog and we can put the link in the show notes. It's 3 years old now, so it's written against Bash. But if you just want a teaser and see what you're buying into, that is available still on my weblog. And it's basically the first chapter of the book.
We'll definitely throw that in the show notes for sure, Armin. Thanks for joining us. I really appreciate having you here, honestly. And I know this is late in the evening for you, so I especially appreciate that as well. Is there anything else that you'd want to share with our audience about how to reach you or anything like that?
I have to say, my wife is a professor in microbiology, and she just passed 2,000 Twitter followers. And I am at 1,900 and something, so please follow me on Twitter.
ScriptingOS10 is your handle?
ScriptingOS10 is my handle on Twitter. It is my name in the MacAdmin Slack where I hang out, well, usually during European time zones. You get up early in the US. I will probably still be around. Pretty much every other social media, you can probably find me at ScriptingOS10.
Well, I know for Jerry's sake and for my sake, I certainly hope we have the listeners to put you over the top. So let's get you there. Thank you again, Armin. I sincerely appreciate it. We hope to have you back again on in the near future. Whether or not you're publishing something new, just to chat with us, would be great to speak to you again.
I will always be happy to come back. Thanks for having me.
Cloud. Joe spins his